I'm Nora Steiner. I'm the president of the United Nations Association of San Francisco chapter. Our chapter and our organization was founded in 1943 and was the predecessor, the predication, for the founding of the United Nations here in San Francisco. Ironically, while the United States prides itself in advising other countries about how to enforce and implement human rights, we here have had the experience in the Bay Area of being visited by a UN Special Rapporteur. He is Philip Alston, and his report is up at the front table. It's an extensive report, and some of it's good news. Lots of good things are happening, and you can see at the back of the room, lots of good things are happening with nonprofits just pitching in and lending a hand and saying, if the government won't do it, we'll do it. And so we have that incredible spirit with us this evening. We also have some bad news, and the bad news is that we see it very visibly on our streets here in San Francisco, and we're aware of the long food lines of people who are hungry, and we're even becoming aware that our students in universities are food insecure. Maybe as many as 20% are food insecure, and maybe as many as 40% have experienced homelessness at one time. So it's affecting everyone, and it could be me, it could be someone else in this room that suddenly has that traumatic experience. So we were looking at 20 topics dealing with the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. We started this series and said it was going to be about homelessness, and lo and behold, it's turning out to be a very pivotal time in the city for public policy and dealing with this situation. And Nelson did agree to take on this topic and to put together this incredible panel and all of these incredible nonprofit organizations. It is Nelson's generosity and his willingness to spend maybe 50% of his time putting this incredible program together. Nelson Berry.
We're very fortunate to have this opportunity to, as the, on behalf of the United Nations Association of San Francisco, in conjunction with the American Legion Post 315, to present this program in our continuing series on human rights. And this year, this month, we're picking homelessness in San Francisco. And it's really a hot topic right now, obviously. Last week, the mayor decided, after getting some bad press from conventioneers, that we may not come back here to San Francisco because it's not really pretty. But what city in America doesn't have a homeless challenge? That's a shot below the belt for us San Franciscans. I'm a native San Franciscan. On my mother's side, we go back 5 generations here in San Francisco. My grandmother, in 1906, on April 18th, was rolled out of bed at the age of 11 onto the floor of the 1906 earthquake. And for the next several decades, they rebuilt San Francisco from Venice Avenue all the way to the Bay, because that's how much of the city was destroyed. And that's the can-do attitude we have. And just 40 years later, in 1945, the United Nations Declaration was signed in this building downstairs, a proud history that we have. And 4 years later, in 1949, the Universal Declaration on Human Rights was promulgated. And number 25 says, I want to get it right. Article 25 of the 1948 Universal Declaration of Human Rights leads off by saying, everyone has the right to a standard of living adequate for the health and well-being of himself and his family. Kind of says something about the day and age. including food, clothing, housing, and medical care. 1945. We live in a time when social services are being cut at the federal level, so more pressure is on the cities and states to pick up the slack. But San Francisco has wonderful men and women who are at the forefront of dealing with social issues like homelessness, and we have some of the best here today representing dozens of organizations that are working hard to bring some compassion and treat homeless people in a humane, compassionate way. Some of those people, as Mary said, are represented by the organizations in the back of the room. I hope you'll stop by and talk to each and every one of them. Miracle Messages teaches you how to, they give you an app, and you on your own phone, when you encounter a homeless person, you can say to them, have you talked to your family in a while? Would you like to talk to your family? And if they don't, yeah, I might, but I don't know how to get a hold of them. So Miracle Messages teaches you how to find people, and then you use the app, and it doesn't cost you anything, it doesn't cost you a dime. And you can put that person in touch with their family, and they've reunited many, many homeless people with their families just through that little act of kindness using a little bit of technology. And we have Project Homeless Connect, which is, I'm gonna give it a general overview, but I love this organization because of what they do. They go out and they find homeless people who have particular needs. And there are dozens of organizations out there to help the homeless, and they try to direct the person to the organization that's going to help them with that particular need, be it help with mental health issues or drug addiction, or they need job skills, or they need medical care. Then the list goes on. So we've got lots of organizations here that are doing really great. Megan, come on up. While she's setting up, let me tell you a little bit about Megan, who's the CEO of Project Homeless Connect, an amazing organization, and also the founder of Simply the Basics. She hails from Chicago and spent 4 years here as the Deputy Director of San Francisco Suicide Prevention. She's ready already. She founded Simply the Basics, the first national hygiene bank, which has received national recognition for innovation. She's been honored as the National Changemaker by Michelle Obama at the United States of Women's Summit. She's a top mentor to women in business for 4 years in a row, and in 2016, she was recognized as the top 40 under 40 person by the San Francisco Business Times. Megan believes that it is the responsibility of the entire community to prevent and end homelessness for our neighbors, and she is grateful to work with a team that prioritizes impact-driven results and compassion in their services. Welcome, Megan.
I've never been told that people can't hear me, but I'll use the microphone anyway, just to be safe. Thank you, Jennifer, for sharing all of that background. I think that it's really important to understand what we can do as a whole city. I'm going to touch upon a little bit more of what we can do as individuals, so hopefully we'll be able to tie that together. So a little bit about Project Homeless Connect, a little background information. Our mission is really simple. Connecting people experiencing homelessness or at risk of becoming homeless to the services they need to move forward. What it means to move forward, we do not define for them. We work with people to understand what goals they are setting, what their needs are, and what their challenges are. So we do have, you know, I think as many organizations, as many nonprofits, a very broad mission statement. And that's because there's a broad amount of needs in the community. A couple of our events, so a quick question. How many people here have attended one of our community days of service? Big events in the room. That is awesome. A study was done recently to find that over 70% of San Franciscans have attended a Project Homeless Connect event, so we are connected to the city. We are connected to the people in terms of volunteering. What we do there, in case you haven't been, they're hosted about 4 to 6 times a year. On-site medical services. That includes Hep A vaccines, flu vaccines, dental exams, vision exams, general doctor visits, podiatry. Podiatry is huge. This is a really big need. If you don't have shoes, if you don't have proper shoes, socks, if you're on your feet all day, you're gonna not only have sores and open wounds, but these are gonna lead to life-threatening infections, and we want to take care of that right away. We provide benefits and assistance and basic needs like groceries, showers, food bank, a lot of services, over 100. So I won't, you know, time is limited, I won't list all 100. I encourage you to go to our site. But what's really, really unique about this is that we found years ago when we were begun that somebody who needed support was spending over 20 hours a week just trying to understand where to go. You might go to sign up for Medi-Cal and you find out that you need identification. So you go to the DMV, but if you have no identification or address, it's really difficult to get identification. So what we said instead is, let's not make it so someone has to go from site to site and wait and wait between all these organizations and services when even they may not fully understand what's needed by the others. Let's bring them in one room. So you go to the table, you find out that you need identification, you walk around the corner down the hall to the DMV to get that identification. We have lawyers there pro bono, bringing all of these to one spot. What's really unique is some people have referred to us as a resource fair. We actually have an expectation that if you come and table at our event, you provide that service on site. It's not just information, it's providing that on site. So that's something that's really important, that's a bit of a misconception. Two misconceptions about Project Homeless Connect. Tell your friends. We are a nonprofit, we are not the homelessness department. So if you're looking for the homelessness department, we'll help get you connected there as well. But we are a nonprofit ourselves, and we are not a resource fair. We are services right there on site. Everything is completely free. There's a lot of trust that comes with going to a service for free, a lot of fear that you're going to be billed for a service. You will never be charged for any services. Not only will you not be charged for a service, we ask nothing of you, which is why we don't even allow photographs at our event. Because as soon as you ask someone, may I take your photo, you've started a transaction. You've said, I'm providing you this service, may you do this for me. We don't allow that. It's not even asked. And like I mentioned, over 1,000 participants will come to these events every single time we host them. So that's really crucial as well. We can reach a lot of people at once with the support of 600 volunteers. Everyday Connect. This began a couple of years ago when we realized that it just was not enough to have these large events a few times a year. So this is our drop-in program. You can come receive hygiene items, DMV, hand up, dental and dentures. It's one of my favorites. We're not supposed to pick favorites, but that dental program is absolutely a favorite. Imagine really coming to someone and saying, I have no funds, I have no insurance, and I have no teeth. That affects your nutrition. That affects your ability to even interact with people and build relationships. It's more than just interviews. People always say, oh, you must be so much more eligible for job interviews. Sure, but you also are going to feel more confident reconnecting with family, reconnecting with people in the community. So this is just such an impactful program I'm really proud of. Prescription and reading glasses. Clearly, it's very important that we're able to see. It's not only the safety of participants, it's the safety of the entire community. To be able to see where you're going when you're crossing the street, to be able to take those next steps. Housing workshops, and as was mentioned in the introduction, connections. That support, understanding what is available to someone, we make sure to offer to you. So Symbia Basics was mentioned briefly. I am going to talk about it. So we're going to talk about collaboration. And because I started it, it's a little bit of a pride point. I want to make sure people know about it. Symbia Basics is a hygiene bank. We're a national hygiene bank. We operate a lot like a food bank. It's not all hygiene products, though. What makes us really unique is that we consider our nonprofit partners our clients. So what we do is we partner with a nonprofit. We're partnered with over 40 in the Bay Area right now. And we say to them, what is it that's taking a lot of time away from your mission? And what we found was it's not just getting the right hygiene products, but it's making sure that you can redistribute what you don't use. A lot of people don't know this, but when you donate to a nonprofit, it's actually against the law for them to throw away what you give to them. They give you a tax deduction, you have to re-donate it. So, you know, if anybody needs a printer, San Francisco Suicide Prevention has about 7. I don't know why people kept donating them. We can't just get rid of it. We actually have to re-donate it to an organization. It's very similar with hygiene products. You get a lot of these products, you get a lot of things you don't necessarily need, and it becomes storage. So what we do is we redistribute to make sure things don't go to waste. The second part of our goal is just improving physical health in the community. So there's a lot of diseases that are coming up that are preventable. Of course, proper hygiene care provides dignity, provides cleanliness, and above all, it provides health. So we never provide anything used. We never provide anything that would negatively impact somebody's health. It's new toothpaste, and it's products based on what somebody needs. We're going to talk a little bit about choice, but choice is so crucial. Not everyone uses the same shampoo. Not everyone uses the same toothpaste. We make sure that what we're providing is what somebody needs for their own self and well-being. So what I want to talk a little bit, and why I've shared these two organizations, is because we really believe in collaborative models. We formed a strategic alliance between Simply the Basics and Project Wellness Connect. And what that means is, while we have different programs, and while our missions may be slightly different, we don't want to duplicate services. And we also want to cut our admin costs in half. So when we have the opportunity to split admin costs, such as having a fundraising event or hosting a table here, we make sure to share that. We make sure to share those resources. The reason why we encourage collaborative models, Project Homeless Connect connects with all these different organizations, is because we recognize that no one organization is an expert in everything. So we want to find the places that are experts. A lot of times organizations duplicate services because of funding. So a donor might say, I'm going to fund dental care for youth. So five organizations start up dental care for youth. It doesn't mean they're all great at it. So rather, we're saying, let's collaborate. Let's do this together. We want to eliminate duplication. We want to share best practices. We want to make sure that we're all encouraging one another. When we learn something works well, we need to be communicating. It, of course, saves on cost, and it holds us accountable. As organizations, we're held accountable if we set certain standards for one another. So how to be involved? I just got my 3-minute mark, so I'm going to make sure I get to this point up here. How you can actually be involved in a community, it's pretty simple, but I do want to give some pieces of advice that a lot of nonprofits don't like to share. A lot of nonprofits don't like to say these things. We like to get you connected really quickly. Volunteering, of course, is huge. We want you to volunteer. What I ask is that when you reach out to volunteer with an organization, you say, what do you need? Really find out how they need a volunteer. It's not necessarily about what your skill sets are to offer, but maybe they need something else in their office. Maybe there's administrative support that they need that would be more helpful to save them time. Because volunteerism is about saving that nonprofit time and saving staffing time, not about giving them another task. Donating, again, ask what do you need from your organization? And give that, and trust the organization to use that as they best see fit. We've heard a lot about different ways that you can advocate and you can vote. Read those propositions. We've seen it make a very big difference. And then compassion. So as a city, we need to be wholly more compassionate. And compassion is more than just what we say. It's kind of like that buzzword of disrupt and for-profit. Compassion is used a lot in nonprofit, but it's actually trackable. So what they have found in cities that declared themselves compassionate cities and made it a point is that people in the community were twice as likely to reach their goals when they were provided a service with compassion. So this actually has evidence that it's not just about giving a resource. It's not just about recognizing that someone has a need, but doing it in a kind way. Some ways to do that are listen to people, hear their story, trust their story, believe them. When they tell you something, when they tell you what caused their homelessness, what led to homelessness, hear that story and really trust their needs. The power of choice. This is really, really crucial. Allow someone to choose their need. I often have people tell me, you know, I saw someone outside and I offered them the rest of my lunch and they didn't want it. I was like, well, yeah, neither would I. Letting someone choose what they want, choose what they need. Something I often like to do is if I see someone in need and I'm near CVS, I say, I can get one thing for you and here, what do you need? Rather than just going in and assuming and bringing it out for them. So if you are in a place where you can provide something for somebody, find out what it is that would really help them. Respecting privacy. Once you've done that, it doesn't mean you need to take their photo and share it. And then just speaking kindly. So you've often heard us use the phrase, people experiencing homelessness up here. That really means something. Because homelessness is not a part of someone's identity. It's an experience that we hope to be temporary, that we want to end. And by using that language, it's not just respectful of the people experiencing homelessness, but it's a reminder to yourself. So as we use this more and more, we're helping one another understand this language and importance. So very quickly, I'm going to just go through these numbers. So a lot of nonprofits are spending too much time managing donations. This is why I really encourage you to ask what you need, rather than just saying, I'm going to do a drive for this and bringing it to them. find out, you know, what do you need? What are you short on right now? 25% of organizations said after a survey was done by Volunteer Match that volunteer activities are often a burden. Nonprofits are making up activities just to get you connected, telling you they need a room painted over and over and over again. So ask an organization, how can my time be valuable? Because all of our time really is valuable. This is going to help prevent budget issues, and it's also going to help prevent burnout because nonprofit employees will be able to focus on their mission. So like I said, some things that are really important, all you have to do is ask yourself, what do you need when you talk to someone, when you talk to an organization, when you think about compassion? Trust that choice. So choice is very empowering. We really believe in the power of choice. And an example of how it can be so powerful where we need to trust people to make their own choice is a little while back, I met a woman, and we all know there's a long wait list for shelters right now, and she was given a bed off of the wait list. And she declined it. And I could not believe that, and I asked her, why would you decline this? I tried to really understand her story. She declined it because it was in a location where her drug dealer was also staying, and she'd been clean for 4 months. I respect that choice to stay where she was at that time and wait for another location. So choice is more than just saying what I'm going to eat today or where I'm going to sleep today. All of these things are taken away when you experience homelessness. You don't just lose your home. You lose the dignity of choosing for yourself what your needs are. So as a community, we can give that dignity back as we're providing for people, as we're engaging with people. And sharing with nonprofits how they need it is going to be really impactful as well. So I know I went a bit over, I apologize. But thank you so much for hearing this and letting you ask yourself what you're going to do.